Hello, Regis football fans. Welcome to tonight's game from J.K. Mullen High School, Brother Bernard de la Salle Stadium, between your Regis Jesuit Raiders and the J.K. Mullen Mustangs. Looks like we have a great game in store tonight. I'm Steven Snyder. My producer's Tommy Radins, cameraman Joe Quigley, and my color man, well, that'll be a surprise for a little later in the game right now. Right now, just give me Raiders have won the toss and elected to receive tonight. Looks like we have a great game on our hands. And looks like here we go, Mullen with the kickoff. And the kick. Be received by number 12 for the Raiders. That'll be fielded in the end zone for a touchback. The Raiders will start on the 20-yard line. Some quick keys to the game for the Raiders. They were beat up in the run game last game against Horizon, and they're going to need some production from their third and fourth string backs, Chase Bertinelli and Jaden Williams, on offense. Mullen just needs to play tough defense and keep with that passing attack that they've been tearing up the league with. So we'll see if both teams can execute on their keys. Matt Hotelling under center for the Raiders, the sophomore quarterback. He's started every game so far. Hotelling under center, Bertinelli Williams in the backfield. Motion by number 17 for the Raiders. Hand off to Williams, who will get stuffed at the line for maybe a gain of one. Oh, that was was that Chuk Ovena? I didn't expect to see him playing today. That'd definitely be a big surprise. Didn't look like Chuk, though. I believe that was actually Chase Bertinelli on the carry because there were no personnel switches there, and he's now in the backfield. Hotelling under center, two men off to the right, two Raiders in motion. Motion playing man for Mullen defense. And that'll be a pitch to Chase Bertinelli. He will get outside, and he will be stopped there for maybe a gain of 3 yards. Raiders executing pretty well in the run game right now. We'll see what they can do here against this run-oriented Mullen defense. Mullen's at defensive end, actually, Schoolcraft, is out with possibly ACL or MCL injury, so that can assist the Raiders, but Raiders have their own problems on the defensive end with Grant Neal. Hotelling under center again, two men out wide, Bertinelli in the backfield. Hotelling drops back, and he'll be sacked by number 7 for Mullen. Big hit there, and that'll be a 3-and-out on the Raiders' first possession, and you really can't have that there for the Raiders. You got to get some production. You got to get forward. You can't go 3-and-out and just kill all momentum you have. So we'll see what the Raiders do here on the punt. Mullen, two men back to receive. Sebastian Harris doesn't look like... I'm fine. Fielded by Mullen, quickly taken down right around the 50-yard line. So Mullen will start with fantastic field position on their first possession. And the Raiders really need to get some momentum going early. We've seen in their past games they have absolutely thrived off momentum. So we'll see if the Raiders can maybe get a 3-and-out of their own here and put Mullen's offense back on, give their defense some rest. Keys for the Raiders' defense are Eddie Gonzalez and Antonio Broaddus. Broaddus very ineffective last week without Grant Neal. Still managed to get a sack. And Eddie Gonzalez leaving the game with 2.5 sacks. So we'll see if the Raiders can get in the head of Mullen quarterback. That's been the key all year for them. Mullen just needs to spread out the field. The Raiders shown to be very ineffective against the West Coast and quick passing offenses. So we'll see if Mullen chooses to exploit that. Mullen with a two-back formation. Two men down to the left. And the handoff to number 30, who is stopped for a short gain of about 3 yards. Mullen, just some good yards there. And if they can do that all night, it looks like the Raiders will really struggle to keep them out of the end zone and out of their own territory. Mullen on the first play crossing into Raider territory, which is, if you're the Raiders, you've got to be concerned already. But we'll see if the Raiders can respond well here. 17 from Mullen under center. It'll be a handoff. Number 36 again. And he will be stopped for a gain of about 6 yards, which will put them with about 1 yard to go. Actually, that was a gain of about 4, excuse me. And I'll leave them with a third and one. We'll see if what formation Mullen comes out with here. Number 17 for Mullen under center. Two-back formation, two down. Same formation they've been using, and I think that'll be a false start on Mullen, folks. Looks like he jumped early. So Mullen definitely trying hard here to Man, you really can't make those mistakes that early in this game. You got a third and one. You got a chance to really push the Raiders back. And now you have a third and six, and you're definitely going to have maybe a personnel change and a play call change. Number 14 checking into the game for Mullen. Looks like they're going to have a four-receiver set. Single back. 17, the quarterback for Mullen in the shotgun. Snaps. Looks for a quick pass. He's going to throw, and that'll be intercepted. Thrown right to number 12, Will Dines. Or number 32, excuse me. It's not Will Dines. Sorry, I'm having a little roster problem here. So for now, we're going to have to stick with numbers. Number 32 thrown absolutely right at the Regis defender. Absolutely poor choice for Mullen. And that's the momentum swing the Raiders needed. You really can't have that if you're Mullen. Third and six, and you just immediately turn the ball over. And now Regis starting with fantastic field position on their own 38-yard line. So we'll see if Raiders can come out here and maybe get more than three and out. Both teams having a possession and only running seven plays total. So we'll see what Mullen can do here. Hoteling with a snap. Hand off to Jalen Williams. Lays out for extra yards, and that'll be about a four-yard one, two, three, four. 5-yard run, excuse me. So 5-yard run for the Raiders there, and that'll be a good gain to start the drive. We'll see here with Mullen defense responds well. Raiders will probably look for another run play. They are a very run-heavy team. Hoteling, in fact, last week only threw three passes, completing two of those for 17 yards. So Raiders definitely a run-heavy team. Stoppage in play, and that will be, I believe there was a holding call. So that'll back the Raiders up first and 18, I want to say. That'll be first and 20 for the Raiders, and you really can't have that setback this early in the game on such a great play. So we'll see what they can do here. Hoteling, four receiver set. Hoteling looks to pass. He's going to air it out, and that'll be caught by the Raiders for a fantastic 25-yard gain and a first down. So we'll see. Raiders here. Line up here after that fantastic 25-yard play. Hoteling under center, two in the backfield, one man on each side. Mullen lining up. Seven in the box. That'll be a handoff, and he'll absolutely be stuffed behind the line. I'm joined here by Jake Leonard. Jake, good to have you.
Hey, folks. I apologize for my absence. I was stuck in, definitely, without argument, the worst traffic of my life, but good to be here. I apologize again.
All right. Great to have you, Jake. And see, hoteling under center, two backs, one man out each side. Handoff to number four, and he'll be stuffed again. So we'll see what they can do here.
So there's an official's timeout on the play. Steven, to recap me and all our listeners, what has happened so far?
Mullen, the Raiders started with a quick three and out. Mullen then ran two fantastic run plays, third and one, but had a false start, and then threw a pick right to number 32 for the Raiders. So there's only been about 9 plays run, but each team is out of possession. This is the Raiders' second.
O'Talling will throw it over the middle to Robert Orban, and it'll go through his hands. So the pass falls incomplete, and it'll be 4th down and 11 on the Mullen 46-yard line.
And, Jake, Raiders absolutely using a lot more throwing than they have in past weeks. In fact, O'Talling has almost reached an equal amount of attempts that he had last week. Again, he only had 3 attempts last week for 2 completions, and he's already thrown twice.
Sebastian to punt from the Regis Jesuit 38-yard line. Good snap. Sebastian's punt is low, but it looks to, and it takes a unfortunate hop for the Raiders into the end zone for a touchback. But that was a pretty good punt, Steven.
That was, and that's better than what we've seen from Sebastian this entire year, Jake. It looks like he's having a good game. I was watching him in warm-up, and he's just been having a good year overall. So with an improvement on a good year, we'll definitely look for more from him later in the game.
A quick note for those of you that may not know, Mullen has a star defensive end, Tim Coleman, who is not playing today. So hopefully the Raiders will be able to do something. And here's a quick pitch. Number 35 will take it out to the 20 and get smushed by number 97.
And number 36 for Mullen, Connor Brady, their senior running back. He's seen the ball a couple of times today, so we'll definitely see what he can do with the ball today, Jake, against this Regis fantastic line.
So Mullen will have 2nd and 10 from the 20-yard line again on the left hash. Number 17 in the shotgun, trips right. He's going to look quickly to the right side and fire to number 36, and he'll evade a couple tacklers, and he's brought down at the 23.
And, Jake, that was a well-designed screen, but looks like the runner there hesitated after catching the ball, couldn't decide what to do, and just waited until he got tackled.
So the Mullen quarterback is number 17, Gaspar Dominici. I believe it's Dominici, Steven.
That sounds right, Jake.
And he's the senior quarterback listed on their roster as 6'2", 186. Pretty good build and size for a quarterback. And Dominici will be in the shotgun again. Regis with 8 in the box. Dominici's going to do a 3-foot drop, flag on the play, and the pass is complete to number 36. Steven, did you see what that flag was for?
I imagine it was holding, Jake. The ref was looking right at the pocket, and there's not really other pocket flags you can have unless it was an illegal block before the quarterback throws it, Jake.
Yeah, Steven, honestly, unless that was offsides on the defense, I can't think of what it would be. And it is an illegal formation on Mullen. So a false start. Interesting that they didn't whistle it dead. But that play will be negated, and it'll be 3rd and 5 more.
And, Jake, we've seen a lot of mistakes from Mullen we really haven't seen over the past 5, even 10 years. With a young team, of course, with the departure of Dave Logan that made headlines. So we'll see if these mistakes continue to be a part of Mullen's game. And so far it's really opened up the door for the Raiders, who are coming into this game as slight underdogs, Jake.
Indeed, Steven. Regis definitely favored to lose this game. Mullen coming in from a pretty solid first-half performance against nationally ranked De La Salle. They did fall off in the second half to lose 30-13.
Yeah, Jake, they had a great first half in that game.
And welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Brother Bernard Kennedy De La Salle Stadium here in Colorado for a great night. We're having some sound difficulties, but hopefully we can solve those. Dominici in the shotgun again, trips left, one receiver on the right. The Raiders not going to blitz. Dominici's going to look over the middle, and he's got number 36 again, Connor Brady, wide open. Steven, that is poor coverage.
And, you know, Jake, it really is. So That coverage is really going to affect the Raiders. But we haven't seen them with fantastic coverage the entire night. So we'll see what they can do here with this coverage. So we'll see if they can really fix that, Jake, because they need it tonight. And, I mean, Jake, that's secondary for the Raiders. We'll see if they can fix that because they're going to need it tonight.
So here's Dominici going to go play action. He's looking deep on the right side. And that's number 32, overshot him, but definitely going for the home run there, Steven.
And, you know, Jake, he really was. And Mullen seemed to be taking a lot of risks early in the game. So we'll see what they can do here. And we'll see if these risks pay off for them. Right now it's really opened the door for the Raiders to look maybe better than they are, but the Raiders definitely looking good tonight, Jake.
5 minutes and 7 seconds left in the first quarter. And the score is 0-0. Dominici going to line up under center. Regis not going to blitz, handoff to number 9, Patrick Healy, and Healy will get a few yards, if any. So that'll set up Mullen with a long third down situation.
And we'll see, Jake, last time Mullen had any third down situation, they weren't really able to convert because of a false start penalty. So definitely try to minimize that. But the last third down Mullen had, they threw a pick. So we'll see if that happens here.
A pretty good turnout, I'd say, Steven, for Regis Jesuit. A lot of students here and a lot of parents in the stands, but definitely a great atmosphere. And here on 3rd and 8, Mullen will try to keep their drive going. Dominici looking left. He's going to scramble out to the right. He's going to run. There's a flag on the play, double flag, so this one's 100% coming back. But, Steven, what are your thoughts about Dominici so far?
You know, Jake, he looks like he's a pretty good quarterback. Definitely poised and mature, but he does look a little skittish in the pocket. He doesn't look quite comfortable there. I don't know if that's maybe because he doesn't trust his D-line or something, but Mullen will definitely need him to get comfortable in the pocket and just sit in there and make the throws he needs to make, Jake.
So that penalty will push Mullen back even further on third down, and they'll have a huge third down play. Steven, so far Regis, I actually haven't seen, but has Chukuma been running the ball at all?
Chukuma has not been running, Jake. And as to my knowledge, I was speaking to some of the coaches earlier. I do not think we will see him tonight unless it is a dire need situation.
So it does indeed seem that the ball will be in the hands of Jalen Williams, Matt Hotelling, and Chase Bertinelli for the duration of this game. It's pretty tough to lose Grant and Chukuma, but hopefully the Raiders will be able to compensate on offense. Here's 17. It's a draw, and a good job by the Raiders to stop that for 2 yards at most, and Mullen has 4th and 20.
And we'll see, Jake. I think on that play, that was a smart call. You just needed to get the ball on a safe play as far up as you could so that you could punt. So definitely smart call by Mullen there to not take the risks they've been taking all game and maybe cost themselves some field position.
4th down and 22, 3:45 left in the first quarter. The snap is good. The punt is a high spiral. Pretty good kick. It's going to be a fair caught. Nope, he'll back away from it. Number 80, Alex Mitchell, and the punt will come to rest at the 30-yard line.
And, Jake, we really haven't seen either team start with terrible field position. Mullen getting maybe a little of the benefit on that. But really, both teams starting in front of the worst field position today has been Regis starting from their own 20. Other than that, this is the worst at their own 30. So we'll definitely see what the Raiders can do here tonight with this field position. So far, they've been utilizing it decently. So.
And here comes Matt Hotelling in the Raider offense. In the backfield, I believe that's Jalen Williams. Raiders going to line up man in motion number 9. Hotelling going to hand off to Jalen Williams. Jalen stays on his feet. He's got a big gain, and he's still on his feet. Cannot get tackled until the 50-yard line. He'll take it into Mullen territory. Steven, phenomenal run.
And really, Jake, that is, and that's the power back we've seen Regis utilizing, and Jalen's going to be the replacement for them. They'll definitely be using Bertinelli in the speed position, but Jalen has become the replacement for Mullen in their trademark power running offense.
So a first down for the Raiders. Great play there. Hotelling going to take the troops to the line once again. Ball on the Mullen 49-yard line. Mullen lining up, five men on the line. Possible blitz here. Man in motion number nine, I believe that's DeJour Elliott. Going to be another handoff to Jalen Williams. This time he gets stuffed in the backfield by a swarm of about five Mullen defenders.
And Jake, Mullen not falling for the typical tricks. Regis is falling for most of the time, or Regis's opponents are falling for most of the time on these quick motions and reverses. I mean, Raiders like to use a lot of motion, and Mullen not really confused so far, so we'll see if Raiders maybe need to change their strategy based on that.
So second down, and maybe a little longer than 10, but man in motion number 19, Orban, going from left to right. Hotelling going to hand it off to Williams, and late stoppage of play. I wonder if they saw a false start but didn't call it until well after the play had been undertaken.
And, you know, Jake, we've seen that before, Mullen throwing a flag or getting a false start flag called mid-play. So we'll definitely see what they do here.
2:23 left in the first quarter. Steven, I'd say Regis has played pretty well. I think if Regis can keep this low scoring, still make it a game in the second half, that's when they can have the best chance of this game. And here is Hotelling again. Jalen Williams behind him. DeJour Elliott going in motion. It's going to be a handoff to Elliott, I believe. And he'll get nothing, so it'll be third and very long for the Raiders.
And, Jake, I don't know if you saw it. Emotion's already high in this game. A couple Raider and Mustangs tearing at each other a little after the play was completely finished away from the ball. So no flags yet, but the ref gave him a warning. So,
yes, ladies and gentlemen, make no mistake. This is a very fierce rivalry. Both these schools are Catholic. We share the same ultimate mission, but we do not like each other on the field. And here on 3rd and 15, we'll see if Hotelling will finally pass. He's going to drop left, throw over the middle to Orban, and it's complete. He's going to be a couple yards short of the first down. But, Steven, I say Regis will go for it here.
I imagine they will, Jake, even with Sebastian Harris punting so well in warm-up and that first punt, which was very well placed just with an unlucky bounce. I imagine they will go for it. So we'll see what they do here, but Hotelling already completing more passes or attempting more passes than he did in the entirety of last game. So the lack of the running backs really forcing Hotelling to maybe move out of his comfort zone and perform.
Fourth and about three for the Raiders. AJ Shaw in motion. It's going to be a handoff to Williams. Williams powering. He's very close to the line. Steven, this might be too close to call.
And based on the spot by the refs, Jake, I don't know if they'll have it. Mullen offense already trotting onto the field from the looks of it. And so it will be a Mullen ball.
That's disappointing, Steven. Even though the result turned out that way, I'd still say that was the right decision. When you're that close into territory, you got to go for it. And with just under a minute to go, 46 seconds exactly, Mullen will take over the ball with a turnover on downs.
And, you know, Jake, really shocking. This is Mullen's worst field position to start this game.
Wow, Dominici going to throw to number one. He's going to take it across the 50-yard line. That's Michael Moore, the senior 5'8 wide receiver. A nice catch, and that'll move the chains for the Mustangs.
And, you know, Jake, they have Mullen actually on all three of their drives have been across the 50-yard line in one play into Raider territory. So we'll definitely see what they can do here.
Under 30 seconds to go. Here's Dominici. Handoff to number 36. He'll weave his way. He's still on his feet. And a great second effort. Steven, he was never tackled. That's unbelievable. I saw that play last year, Michigan versus Iowa. He never touched his knee on the turf. He kind of fell on top of a Regis defender, and he takes that into the house.
And if you're the Raiders, you got to make sure you finish the tackle, Jake. Back to fundamental tackling. Just because you think the guy is down, you got to go with the hard-hitting Raiders and take him all the way to the ground. Really unfortunate there for Regis.
That's number 36, Connor Brady, the senior 5'10", 177 running back, taking that into the house for the Mustangs. And just like that, Mullen's up 7-0. The extra point is up, and Marcus Harrison splits the uprights. So with exactly 16.4 seconds to go in the first quarter, Mullen has a 7-0 lead. We're going to take a quick break here on RJ Live, but we'll be right back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Mullen High School. Marcus Harrison with the kickoff. It'll be fielded at around the 1 yard line. That's number 12 taking it off across the 15 yard line, going to make it to maybe the 17 yard line. So poor field position for the Raiders to start this drive.
Number 12 there for the Raiders returning, Will Dines. He brought that 88 yard fumble return back last week to secure the game. And I guess the Raiders saw his speed and said, maybe we'll try him out on the return team with the absence of Chukwuma and Grant Neal.
So here come the Raiders offense once again. Let's see if they can make anything with these last 10 seconds of the first quarter. Once again, Regis down 7-0 on the big, probably 50-yard touchdown scamper by Connor Brady. But here's Hotelling. He's going to hand it off. That looked like Bertinelli. And Bertinelli got slammed.
By number 7 there, Castillo Byers, senior linebacker from Mullen, absolutely just ripping Bertinelli off the ground and throwing him down there in an all-inclusive spinning move. So Mullen, really a vicious defense here to end the first quarter. And the Raiders, you got to think they got to be concerned, Jake. You want to keep it close. And after that play to end the first quarter, you really don't have the momentum, which the Raiders thrive off of.
So after one period of play, this crowd here in Denver is hopping up and down for the Mustangs. Got some good songs here, Steven.
And Jake, actually before the game, we were talking about that. They had a fantastic music selection. A lot of old hits. I know there was Slow Ride and some other fantastic songs, but really, whoever chooses the music here, shout out to them because they're doing a fantastic job.
I second that, Steven. And really, other than that one long touchdown run, the Raiders have played phenomenally well, both offensively and defensively. Hotelling made a couple good passes. That drive just unfortunately stalled out a couple inches short on fourth down. And the defense picking off Dominici. So some pretty promising first quarter happening, Steven.
Yeah, Jake, and we'll see what the Raiders can come out and do here. I definitely think Hotelling is throwing the ball really well, and I think they need to utilize those deep passes. He's actually had two pass plays now for over 15 yards, so he's throwing way better than he has in past games. We'll see if they can utilize him here.
And, folks, we're not being sarcastic. That actually is very good progress for Matt Hotelling because I believe he only had one pass completed last game, and it was a little screen. Two, excuse me, Steven. And here's AJ Shaw in motion. Hotelling going to fake a handoff. He's going to throw it up long to Alex Mitchell. He was held. There is a flag on the play. Alex Mitchell held. That's number 4 for the Mustangs. Nigel Vaughns. And, Steven, I say good call on that.
You know, that was a great call, Jake. And the official actually throwing that while the ball was in midair. He didn't even have to see if Alex Mitchell caught that. That was such interference because he couldn't even get by him, and the Mullen player really impeding progress. So that's definitely a fantastic call there, Jake.
And sadly, Steven, there was a holding penalty as well on the Raiders, so those two penalties will cancel out. And that's a bad mistake for the Raiders because I don't really see how that holding penalty helped at all. Hotelling got that pass off extremely quickly. That's very disappointing.
And that goes back to the discipline issues the Raiders have been having in the first couple weeks, Jake. Coach Nolan making leaps and bounds, but he's still got a ways to go.
So the Raiders do lose the down. They'll replay the down. 2nd and 11. Hotelling under center, 2 receivers left. And there's a stoppage of play. Ooh, these penalties are starting to add up on the Raiders, Steven.
And they really are, Jake. If this is a false start, I believe it is. It is. So false start on the Raiders, and that's really making them have some trouble here, so we'll see what they can do. From 2nd and 16, I believe, Jake, or 3rd and 16?
2nd and 17 for the Raiders, Steven. Ball on their own 11-yard line. So Regis not doing a good job putting themselves into favorable positions. Here's Hotelling under center, two receivers right. He's going to do a draw to, I believe that was Jalen Williams, and that did nothing. So it'll be 3rd and very, very long, almost a for sure passing situation.
I can't see them running here, Jake, especially with how well Hotelling's been throwing the ball and the coverage of the Mullen defense being penalized twice already here. So we'll see if we'll definitely probably see Hotelling throw it here, Jake.
11:14 left in the second quarter. Here's Hotelling under center. Two receivers left, one right. He's going to look right. Quick pass over the middle, almost intercepted by number 5, Austin Smith, the senior defensive back. He underthrew his intended receiver just a tad on that, Steven.
And you know, Jake, he looks a little skittish in there. Just looks like he wants to get the ball out of his hands as quickly as possible. And that made him only take one read. Once he saw a decent read, he threw it. Number 9 was on the outside there, and really he looked like he could have gone possibly all the way if he'd made a decent throw.
11:03 left in the second quarter. Sebastian Harris, the punt from his own end zone, gets the punt off. It'll bounce it around the 45-yard line of the Raiders and takes a fortunate bounce into Mullen territory. So let's see, that's about a 45-yard punt, so a nice job by Sebastian to give Mullen not the best field position.
And, you know, Jake, we'll see if they can continue their streak of being in Raider territory after just one play. So we'll definitely see if the Mullen Mustangs can continue that momentum.
So Dominici trots out the Mullen offense. From the I formation, going to hand off. That's number 36, Connor Brady. And Brady will take it for a pretty big gain across into Regis Jesuit territory to the Mustang 48, a gain of about 7.
Really haven't heard anything from the Regis D line tonight, which is really a concern because that's their defensive key. Their secondary and their deep backs mediocre and pretty average, but their D line has been spectacular so far this year. So we'll see if Eddie Gonzalez or Antonio Brades can get something going for him.
Yeah, Steven, your man, Eddie Gonzalez. Dominici going to hand off again to Brady. Brady this time gets stuffed, and that'll set up a 3rd and almost identical situation for the Mustangs.
And, you know, Jake, we'll see what the Raiders do here, whether they drop back into pass coverage or whether they keep looking for the run from Connor Brady, because Connor Brady has been so effective all day.
3rd and 2 for the Mustangs. Dominici going to line up under center once again. Two receivers left. Regis lining up in what looks like a 4-3, and he's going to pass to number 1. Number 1 wide open, missed tackle there. And that'll be about a 12-yard gain. Pass complete to Michael Moore. So a little unexpected play calling for the Mustangs that pays good dividends. A Mustang first down.
And, Jake, we really see the Raiders' secondary being exploited there. So we'll see if the Mustangs continue to exploit that. As I mentioned earlier, that they'd be looking to exploit that because the Raiders' deep backs really not quite up to par with where they'd like to be.
9:20 left to go in the second quarter. Dominici going to be in the shotgun now. Regis going to blitz on the left side. There's a flag on the play. Pass is complete to across the 30-yard line to number 3, Casey Miller, but the way that flag was thrown right as the play commenced, Steven, I think this one is against Mullen.
I'm really wondering with these false starts, Jake, why the refs are letting the play go through. These are usually dead ball whistles. These plays are usually whistled dead. So this could be using up crucial energy for later in the game that might really affect the outcome. So I don't know if these refs just usually let the play run or that's just the way they usually do it. But normally the play is stopped there, Jake.
Yeah, Steven. The only reason I can think of is that it's an illegal formation or something like that where they'll let the play run through its entirety, and then the defense gets to pick whether it wants them to accept the penalty or just accept the play. So here's Dominici in an I formation. He's going to fake left, scramble left, and the pass is incomplete to Patrick Healy. So it'll be third and 15 for the Mustangs. Let's see if the defense can make a stop.
And, Jake, that'll be absolutely crucial for the Raiders. So we'll see what they can do here. The Raiders, I think, need to look into pass formation because Mullen has been throwing a lot in these situations.
8:43 left to go. Ball on the Regis Jesuit 40-yard line. Dominici scrambling back. He's going to throw a little screen across the middle. A beautiful job by number 10 to stuff that wide receiver screen pass. Number 9, Patrick Healy, the attempted receiver, gets maybe, and in fact, he gets really nothing. That's Quinn Vandekoppel with the great read and great tackle. So it'll be 3rd and 15 now.
And Jake, Raiders looking, definitely we're looking for the throw there. I imagine we'll see another one here. Connor Brady, great back, but only averaging about 6 yards this season a carry, and the Regis defense has been holding him under that to about 4, so I can't see them running the ball here looking for a good punt or possibly go for it. They'll probably throw.
And indeed, Dominici going to look left across. Oh, I don't believe that. It was tipped by number 40, but caught by Connor Brady. Wow. That reminds me of the RG3 pass against Oklahoma last year. Not quite that epic, but it was tipped by number 40 of the Raiders and then caught by Brady off the tip. And Mullen gets first and goal.
Dominici absolutely gave that play to the Raiders, and the Raiders ran, sprinted, and handed that play straight back to the Mustangs. That could have been his second pick there, second pick for the Raiders, and absolutely swung the momentum. But instead, Mustangs gained a ton of momentum and trickle into the red zone.
So really, Steven, the two biggest plays that the Mustangs have done have been pretty lucky. Now Dominici going to look left. No one's on number 3, and he still dropped it. Ooh, that's a bad drop for Mullen. He had a touchdown, Casey Miller. Fortunately, the Raiders get some luck on their side.
And definitely, Jake, we'll see here what the Raiders can do in the deep red zone. They are a goal line defense, as we've seen. They're fantastic inside the 5-yard line, so we'll see if they can keep that tradition up here in this game.
So it'll be second and 2 for the Mustangs. Brady going to power up, second and goal, and Brady will take that inside the 5 to about the 2-yard line now with 7:20 to go.
And Jake, it'll be an interesting situation here if the Raiders can stop him here. Do you think they'll kick, or do you think they'll maybe go for it?
I think Mullen has a pretty good kicker, so with a 1-touchdown lead already, I would think that they would go for the points, but I'm not sure. So here we go, 3rd down and goal. Dominici lining up in an I formation. He's going to hand it off up the middle and into the end zone for a touchdown. I think that was Connor Brady, yep, number 36. So with 6:54 to go in the first half, Mullen is now up 13-0. Steven, that was pretty much, that touchdown was created with a really lucky play.
And, you know, it definitely was, Jake. I think the crucial thing here for the Raiders is to get back out there and score right away. They need to score on this drive to keep themselves in the game and not hang their heads low going into the locker room.
The extra point is up and good, so Mullen now on top 14-0. We're going to step aside for a quick break, but we'll be back on RJ Live. Marcus Harrison with the kickoff. fielded at about the goal line. That's number 12, Will Dines. And once again, before we continue our coverage, we'd like to apologize for our internet issues. They do seem quite constant, but hopefully we'll be able to fix it sometime, and maybe we'll get a good broadcast.
And to all our viewers at home, we'd like to ask you to stick with us because we know it does cut out, but you will get to see the entire game. And definitely, if not, please check the quick score on Max Preps. That'll give you updates throughout the entire game of possession changes and scores. So
6:49, and it's a hand up off the middle. I think that was Chase Bertinelli on that. I wasn't quite sure, Steven, but a pretty minimal gain, and it was Chase Bertinelli. So not a whole lot on that play. The Regis running game not looking as sharp as of late.
And I think, Jake, I think they need to go to Matt Hotelling. They look like they're in a three receiver set, so I imagine that's what they're thinking.
6:19 to go. Hotelling under center, two receivers left. Man in motion, DeJour Elliott. And there's another flag on the play. This time it would be blown, but still a little after the play started. Not too crazy about these refs.
And, you know, Jake, I'm not a fan of their style of reffing either, but it looks like they're getting a lot of the calls right. So I do like that, refs that get the calls right and don't really affect a game with poor calls. Even though their style might be different, they're getting the calls in there and not just letting the plays run, which I really appreciate.
Yeah, I qualify that. I wasn't going against the refs' play, the actual calls they've been making, just the way that they seem to be calling these false start or illegal formations awfully late. But here's Robert Orban in motion, going to the right, Hotelling under center. He's going to hand it off to the left, and that's Jalen Williams. Jalen Williams will take it to about the 24-yard line. So that's a gain of about 5 for the Raiders. It'll be 3rd and 5.
And, you know, Jake, we'll see what the Raiders can do here. I imagine they'll be throwing it with Hotelling. So we'll definitely see what the Raiders have going. But I can't really see a run here, Jake, just because Mullen's been stuffing them.
3rd down and 5. We'll see if Hotelling will get the green light to throw a pass. Two receivers on the right. Mullen with 4 men up front. 3 linebackers looking to possibly blitz. Man on the left looking to blitz. Hotelling, he's going to roll out. Running back slipped. I can hear the Regis coaches in the next room. They are not happy that play blown up. And Regis will be forced to punt.
And I think it might have been a handoff, Jake, but it looks like Jalen Williams out there slipped before Hotelling slipped. So we'll see what they can do here. Definitely see if Sebastian Harris can get him out of another jam, get a decent punt off.
4th down and 14 to go. Sebastian standing on the goal line of the Raiders. And it's a good snap. Sebastian with the punt. A nice line drive kick. Fielded at the 45. Missed tackle by number 29. And number 1 will take it across. That's a block in the back. This one will be coming back. Ended up being tackled by his own man, number 6, Nick Brotzman. But that return will be negated. And actually better field position than the punt would have gotten alone if fair caught.
And Jacob, we'll see here. That definitely was a block in the back call. We both saw that. But this will probably be the worst field position Mullen's starting with all game. And to say that about Mullen starting on the 34-yard line is really scary for the Raiders.
Yeah, anytime you can start on your 34, that's pretty good, Steven. Especially if that's the worst field position of a half. Under 5 minutes to go in the first half. And we'll see if Dominici can string together some passes here. Dominici going to line up. Two receivers left under center. Kind of a flank on the left side. He's going to pass. He's looking left, looking pretty deep. He's going to gun it down the left side to number 1. And almost caught. Almost caught by number 1, Michael Moore. But a good job on the coverage. I believe that's Will Dines.
Shane Moody there, Jake. You can tell by his size that he usually doesn't get to cover the big receivers, but great defense there by Shane.
So Dominici not afraid at all to air it out long. Second and 10 now for the Mustangs. Two receivers left, one tight end flank on the right, and there's going to be a pitch to the right side. That's number 36, Brady, going to tiptoe his way across the 35-yard line to the 39. Spotted across the 40, nope. So gain of about five.
And Jake, good play by the Mustangs there, but not what they were looking for, ending up in another third and long situation. We'll see if they can convert here, if the Raiders can hold them. It's been about 50-50 so far.
Third down and five for the Mustangs. Dominici lining up in the shotgun. And the pass will be blown dead. The play will be blown dead. Flag on the play. Good quick call by the refs. And offsides on the Raiders. So it'll be third and very short for Mullen now.
And, Jake, if you're the Raiders, you really got to be concerned about that. You got Mullen on the ropes, a chance to get the ball back with not too much time. So we'll see what they're doing. Looks like Mullen's changed their play with another quick huddle.
Third down in inches, 4:41 in the first half. Dominici in the I formation. Handoff. Brady scampering on the left side. That's a first down. He'll take it just to about midfield on the Mustang 49-yard line for a first down.
And if you're the Raiders, you can't be happy with that outcome, Jake, because a run like that actually wouldn't have gotten the first down. There's another flag on the play on Mullen. Looks like it'll be coming back for another third down.
Wow.
Motion.
Wow, so Mullen just got a first down, and then it all went for nothing. And we're back in the same situation we were before the offsides penalty on the Raiders. Third and six once again. Dominici now going to line up in sort of a flex pistol with a halfback behind him. He's going to look right, throwing. Number 14, overthrown. Fourth down and six, punt time for the Mustangs.
And Jake, first of all, I'd like to mention to our viewers, I believe we found out the source of our internet problem. So call your friends, have them tune back in if they've tuned out, because it looks like we're going to have a fantastic game here tonight. Definitely, we'll see what the Raiders do here. Haven't forced Mullen to punt yet. Doesn't look like the Raiders. Oh, they are sending Will Dines back there. So timeout Mullen. We'll see if they're maybe going for it, Jake. I mean, I don't see why you'd call a timeout here. I can't exactly see the clock with how much time's left on it. Can you, Jake?
4:12 left as Jump Around is played across the stadium. Such a great song for college football and high school football. But, Steven, in all seriousness, I would really question the decision to go for it. Not only is it risky, but it pretty much signifies a total lack of respect for the Raiders, that they don't think that their offense can do anything with the ball on the Mullen 44, 39 actually.
And you know, Jake, we've seen that in the last 2 weeks too. Other teams just not having respect for the arm of Matt Hotelling and the running backs of Raiders. And we'll see. It looks like they're still in pump formation, but Raiders definitely need to be cautious here.
So indeed, Mullen will line up at a punt formation. John Scott to kick. Alex Mitchell to return for the Raiders. The snap is good. Smith's kick is very high and long. That's a nice punt. Alex Mitchell will fair catch it inside his own 20-yard line. Very pretty high school kick. That'll set the Raiders up within their own 20-yard line.
Smart play there by Alex Mitchell. He didn't wave his arm too early, and I got scared there that he might get absolutely crushed there, Jake, and possibly force a muffed punt or something. But Raiders having the ball, poor field position, but it looks like they can still do something.
4:05 left to go in the second quarter. Matt Hotelling back to lead the troops out on offense. two receivers right, Mullen, four men up front, four linebackers looming 5 yards back, and Hotelling's going to hand it off on the right side to Jalen Williams. Jalen Williams will try to make some men dance a little too much horizontally, and that will not be a gain for positive yards.
I was thinking the exact same thing, Jake, and you got to run vertically to gain any yards. You don't gain any yards running side to side, so I think the Raiders need to focus on that, Jake.
A good job by Jalen Williams, though. I mean, the kid's done so much in the absence of Grant Neal and Chukma. So 3:30 to go in the first half. Regis better start hurrying it up if they want to actually make a long drive. Two men on the left. Mullen looking in a 4-3. Hotelling going to scramble out to the left side. He's looking downfield. He lobs it up in the air pretty deep to Alex Mitchell. Overshot him. Alex Mitchell had a hand on number 24 for Mullen. That's Kevin Rayfield, but I don't think there was any pass interference.
It looked, Jake, that Alex might have been watching the defenders too much and not looking for the ball there. He only saw the ball at the last second. In fact, he only really saw it when it became in front of his face and too low to catch. So we'll see if the Raiders air it out again.
Third down and 10 for the Regis Jesuit Raiders. 3:16 to go in the first half. Hotelling, two receivers left. Man in the backfield. He's going to drop back, look left. He's going to throw it to number 9, DeShore Elliott. A nice catch, and there's a flag on the play in the backfield. Let's pray, Steven, that this is not on the Raiders.
I'm hoping it's roughing the passer. So we'll see what the call is. It was a fantastic play there. Raiders finally got a first down. Here comes a ref.
Steven, if this is a holding penalty, how demoralizing is this for the Raiders?
And it is, Jake. It is a holding penalty. If you're the Raiders, you've just got to be out of momentum by this point.
One thing Regis normally prides themselves on is discipline. But through three games, I see a lot of room for improvement for Nolan's squad. Really a lot of dumb penalties that have negated good gains. I mean, look at this, Steven. It's like 4th and 25 now on their own 5.
And I think, Jake, that comes with the age of the team. They are a very young team here, so that discipline is something you have to learn and build upon over years of playing.
Two receivers on the left. Hotelling under center, even though it's 4th and 25. Mullen probably going to do a prevent defense here. Elliott in motion. And another stoppage of play. I think I've seen more sort of false start illegal motions combined in this game than I have in a first half ever of football. This is pretty impressive. 2:47, and the Raiders, because they're within their own 10-yard line, they'll only move about 2 yards back because they were already so far back. But I wonder if these plays are just designed, and they're designed to be illegal, or if the Raiders just can't execute them.
I know, Jake, that's 9 penalties for the Raiders now, and that's only the first half, so this could be a big problem for the Raiders.
Yeah, playing like the Oakland Raiders, just no discipline. Hopefully they can fix that during the break. 2:30, and they're just going to run it, and that's nothing. So I guess the coaches just want to give Sebastian some room, even though that didn't even work. So we're going to see. Do you think Mullen takes a timeout here, Steven?
I don't think they take a timeout, Jake, because you're going to have such good field position. You could use that timeout later down the road. I imagine Regis will let it run, but I don't think we'll see a timeout from Mullen here.
Under 2 minutes to go in the first half. Sebastian Harris pretty much tiptoeing the back line of the end zone. Got to make sure he doesn't step backwards because that's a safety. Back to return for the Mustangs. Two men. I'm not sure who that is. I think one of them was Michael Moore.
Looks like they're
and
inside
Raider
territory.
And there is a flag on the play. I think that's delay of game. This is a
disaster. This is a disaster for the Raiders, and it's a nightmare right now. If you're Coach Nolan, you're hoping you wake up here soon.
These penalties, I've seen almost every sort of penalty that's just unacceptable for the Raiders, but now 4th down, Sebastian really dealing with not that much room. 140. They're waiting for the clock to run down. The clock's still running, even though it was a delay of game penalty. That's interesting. And here's Sebastian. The punt, it gets shanked or blocked, I'm not sure. And it'll bounce to about the 35, picked up by Michael Moore. Michael Moore taking it inside the 30. He's still on his feet. He'll take it down to the 25-yard line. So Mullen will have 113 to try to put some more points on the board.
If you're the Raiders, Jake, you only have one thing you want here, and that is no points. Or actually, if you're the Raiders, the goal isn't even no points anymore. The goal is don't let them in. There are three flags on the field, Jake. Hold your horses. Let's see what this is.
Folks, this has not been a pretty game on either side. I'm a little harsh on the Raiders just because of all the penalties that seem to happen in a really short period of time, but Mullen has just had as many poor penalties as the Raiders. Steven, really, both teams shooting themselves in the feet, but then the other person shoots themself in the foot, so it's just like a self-injury afflictment battle.
And Jake, the only reason the Mullen coach isn't having as bad of a nightmare as Coach Nolan is they've at least put some points on the board, whereas the Raiders have put none. If these are all separate penalties, Jake, that brings our total to 19 penalties. And I don't know if it's nerves. I don't know if it's the rivalry. I don't know if it's just vicious play. But I imagine these are at least one of the same penalties. But we have 16 penalties. And there's at least a flag on this play. So we'll see what happens.
The referees are in conference to make sure that they come up with the correct ruling on the field. Because it was a punt return, my first reaction is that it's some sort of block in the back or holding on Mullen. And it is unsportsmanlike conduct on Mullen and on the Raiders. Nope, two on Mullen, and the third one is on Regis. So that's two unsportsmanlike conducts on Mullen and one on Regis. So 30 minus 15 is 15. So that'll push the ball 15 yards back.
So now penalties, 11 for the Raiders, 8 for Mullen. And that was that scuffling I was talking about earlier, Jake. It was the exact same players. So those players, I don't know if they know each other from Little League football. If one was a Hawk and one was a Spartan maybe. But definitely some anger issues between those players and that Mullen on the 36. So
these emotions are flaring here, folks, at Mullen High School. 113 to go in the first half. Dominici under center, one man left. Dominici's going to pitch it. He's going to throw it now. Number 9 throwing it down the field to number 1. J.J. Kilgore there for the interception. Tackled by number 13. Ooh, a good idea, but Patrick Healy's pass was straight to J.J. And a nice job by J.J. to make the good interception.
And Jake, number 9 there. Patrick Healy, the man who threw it, he had great pocket presence. But if you're running a trick play, you don't want great pocket presence. You want to get that ball out of there as quickly as can. You want that to be boom, boom, boom. And he threw into 4-on-1 coverage because he waited so long.
So, Steven, we'll see here if the Raiders want to run some final plays. My guess is that Nolan will want to get this into the half. We'll see. It would be nice to see Hotelling throw some before the half is over. One minute. Hotelling looking left and not looking anywhere fast enough. He gets sacked.
I imagine if you're the Raiders, Jake, after a play like that, you're going to just take it to the locker room. I can't see them doing anything else. But they might air it out again. But you need to keep Hotelling safe. And if that means taking it to the locker room, take the two you were expecting to go down in three with that Mullen position until they threw that pick. So I say you take the 2-touchdown deficit and just go into the locker room, Jake.
30 seconds to go. And Hotelling taking his time, getting the play in. Steven, I believe you're right. Looks like Regis will just take this into the locker room. And there's a timeout on the field by Regis. So I guess they are going to talk this over. Seems a little peculiar why you would call a timeout if you're just going to kneel it, but maybe he just wants to tell his team to kneel it or run some run play to get the half clock winded down.
And, Jake, the only thing I can really think of here is that he was minimizing any mistakes they might have, letting Hotelling throw deep, and if Mullen does intercept it, they won't have time to run maybe a quick drive or a deep pass by Domenici. So I think they might be trying to minimize mistakes, but we'll see what they do here. Really can't tell right now.
18 and a half seconds to go in the second quarter. Once again, Mullen up 14-0, a long run by Connor Brady, and then another touchdown run by Connor Brady from short out, but two really lucky plays. One of them, Brady, kind of falling on a Regis defender, never touching the ground, scampered up his way to the end zone. And the other one, a tipped pass that was fielded by a Mullen receiver. Just really two lucky plays that have set up their touchdowns. So here's Hotelling with 18 and a half seconds left. See if he runs or passes. And he's going to hand it off to Chase Bernelli. Chase Bernelli has a seam, and he's at the 30, the 40. Chase kind of stumbled a bit, but why is the clock still running? Okay, but Chase almost hesitated for a second, and I feel like if he had just gone, he would have had a lot more room.
And Jake, I don't know if that hesitation is actually what brought him there. He looked. We'll see. Raiders now definitely have a chance to throw into the end zone, so we'll see what they do here. Maybe a quick throw setting up. They do call a timeout. Really exciting here, Jake. Raiders actually giving themselves an opportunity. And now is when you go back, Jake, and you might regret letting the clock run off after a play like that, because Regis could have 30 to 40 seconds on the clock if they hadn't let it run down.
And real quick, let's give a shout-out to Andrew Reel, who is going to help us with the halftime show with Joe Quigley. It's the Raider Recap. Andrew Reel, one of the most knowledgeable guys about the sport. And just a chill guy in general. So, Andrew, say hi. We'll get you on in a sec.
Howdy.
I am a fan, Steven, of this music. This is very good sound. It's a very good soundtrack.
I know, Jake. And we'll see what the Raiders do here. Do you think they'll maybe try a quick pass and try off the leg of Vince Saban or Harrison Thrasher for a long field goal, or do you think they maybe bomb it to the end zone? Do you know if they have any timeouts left, Jake?
I don't. The scoreboard actually doesn't show timeouts, but I don't think that they have enough time to complete a play in 6.6 seconds, even if they did have another timeout. I'm assuming Hotelling's going to bomb it here. One-on-one on the right side, and Hotelling will scramble back. A late release. That's to Robert Orban, and Robert Orban lost track of the ball. 0.8 seconds left for the Raiders to run a third play, and another piece of laundry on the field, roughing the passer. That's 15 yards for the Raiders, and now, Steven, the one situation that is probable, this would be about a 50-yarder, though.
Yeah, that's a little long, Jake, but if Robert Orban would have caught that, he might have been home free, but this really gives the Raiders a chance, Jake. Really exciting here. I don't think we'll see a kick, but I imagine we will see a four-receiver set. And the key here is the Regis O-line needs to hold the Mullen D-line.
If we had Sebastian Janikowski, we would kick. But we're the Regis Jesuit Raiders, not the Oakland Raiders. So with 0.8 seconds, Hotelling's going to scramble out to the right, looking. A bit of a hold. Hotelling going to throw it deep down the sideline to number four. And it's picked up, but there's a flag on the play. There's a flag on the play. I think that's against Mullen. So this is all for nothing. And a penalty on the defense means that there will be one more play. The half cannot end with a penalty on the defense.
Jake, if this is pass interference, Raiders have a legitimate kick. There's also there's two flags on the field, Jake. And this is ridiculous now. 21 penalties in the half and counting. If these do cancel out, Jake, does the half end?
If these offset, I think the half would indeed end. And I have to say, Steven, even though that pass interference penalty helped Regis, I really did not see pass interference. That was a pretty generous call. It looked like just good coverage. So we'll see if the official call is pass interference on Mullen. And holding on the Raiders. So they'll offset. And looks like there's one more untimed down. That's a bit of a bummer, Steven, because That would have put the Raiders in field goal range, possibly an opportunity to get some points on the board.
Jake, it looks like they still have the ball.
So, Regis has called its final timeout. We are positive that that was the third timeout. But really, Steven, did you see pass interference on that play?
Jake, I think that the pass interference play was not on the intercepting player, but the second Mullen player there. It looks like the reason he was able to get the interception was the other Mullen player actually yanked down the Regis receiver, and I think that's where the call came from, which one might not have seen if you were looking at the ball.
So overall, not an awful first half by the Raiders, 14 points down, but again, like I was saying, two really fortunate plays for the Mustangs, putting them in. One of them gave them the touchdown, the other one set them up with a first and goal. Really, Regis, I'd give them a B for this half.
Scary thing, Jake, is that Regis is actually competing with Mullen. They're within one penalty of the points Mullen has. They have 13 penalties. Mullen has 10.
Hoteling under center, three receivers to the right. He's going to roll out right again. This looks like a similar play. He's going to look left now. Number 24, intercepted by number 24. The end of the half, number 24, Kevin Rayfield. And that's the end of the half for the Raiders, 14-0. We're going to hand you over to the Raider recap with Joe and Andrew. Andrew, welcome.
We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back with the Raider recap.
Test. Welcome back, everybody. This is Joe Quigley along with Andrew Reel for your Raiders recap at halftime of the Mullen game. Right now it is 14-0 Mullen Mustangs. And so far there have been 23 penalties in this game, 13 on the Raiders and 10 on the Mullen. What does that say about this game, Andrew?
It definitely says that there's a big lack of discipline on both sides of the ball, but it's just a matter of Mullen being able to capitalize on those mistakes that Regis made, and Regis can't capitalize on the Mullen ones.
And also bring up, there have been three interceptions thrown by Raider quarterback Matt Hotalian. What does that say about our offense and or Mullen's defense?
Well, one, the first thing about Mullen's defense is Mullen always, always has a good defense. And without a doubt, it's definitely a senior-led team, especially down there at that outside linebacker hybrid defensive end, Pat Healy. And getting that pressure on Hotalian definitely makes it hard for him back in the pocket. And you got to remember, Hotalian's a young buck. I mean, he's a sophomore playing in perhaps one of the biggest games of the regular season, Regis Mullen. So this is a big stage for Hotalian, but give him some time to calm down. I think he'll do good.
The Raiders have also intercepted two passes from Mullen quarterback Gaspar Dominici. How can the Raiders capitalize on those chances?
Well, the Raiders can capitalize on these chances by just, getting solid, sustainable drives based on these interceptions. And if they can do that, then the game's won. I mean, it's just a matter of interceptions and who could capitalize on them.
The Mullen Mustang running back has had a big game tonight. Had a lot of carries for a lot of yards, even a touchdown from about a big 40-yard run. How do the Raiders stop him from keeping doing what he's doing?
Those defensive linemen maintain their gaps. Those linebackers come up and fill, and we should start seeing some stops. I have tremendous faith in this Raider defense, as I know how they've been coached. They're going to come out with a kick-your-ass kind of mentality.
Coming into the second half, what do the Raiders need to do differently to win this game?
Well, to win this game, the Raiders just have to come out. They have to get some sustainable drives. They have to stay calm, and they have to remember that this is a winnable game. They're still in it, and there's plenty of time left.
It's also important to note that the Raiders' defense has held Mullen to only 14 points in an entire half of football. That's a testament to how strong this defense is and how much they will not quit. The offense has got to come out there and play the Regis football that they've been playing all year.
Yeah, definitely. The Raiders just have to come out here, stay composed, and we should start seeing some points on the board.
Absolutely, and that's been your Raiders recap with Andrew Real and Joe Quigley. See you again at the start of the third quarter.
for our second half of play. Vince Saban to kick off for the Raiders. It's a short kick, and Saban just got destroyed on the other end of that. It's kind of a cheap shot by Mullen. But the run back goes to the 30-yard line. Steven, did you see what happened?
No, I didn't, Jake, but definitely a problem. So we'll see here. No foul there because he is a player on the field, but you really don't like to see that to start a half, Jake, just getting the bad blood in there. Tension's already high, and it is a rivalry game, so they're just escalating it.
Yeah, I would say a little inappropriate on that by Mullen. But here, Mullen will start their drive on the 30-yard line. Handoff from Dominici, and that ball will be taken across the 35-yard line.
Jake, what did you see in the first half that you think both teams could really either improve on or keep doing?
Well, Steven, I think that for both sides, discipline's going to be a huge problem. Both teams need to cut down on the penalties. Stop making so many false starts, formation calls, holding penalties. If they can do that, both teams will put themselves into good field positions, and that's what's key. Dominici lining up, two receivers on the right. Second and four, it's going to be a pitch to Brady. Brady will cut it across the 45-yard line for a first down.
And, you know, Jake, Mullen coming out looking like they have a fire that they didn't have in the first half. Both teams making a lot of mistakes, but being able to recover from in the first half, I think both teams will really look to just play disciplined, solid, fundamental football, Jake. And that team, the team who can do that the best, will win this game.
Well said, Steven. 11 minutes to go in the third quarter. Dominici bringing his troops to the line. Mullen's going to be in an I formation. Raiders lining up. Four men up front. Three linebackers. Dominici's going to fake the handoff, scramble out to the right. Nice pass. That's to number nine, Patrick Healy, who's wide open. He'll cut it across the 40, the 30. He's got a lot of green space in front of him across inside the 10 to about, wow, the refs are spotting him at about the 6-yard line, but a huge gain on what was just a little dump pass, Steven.
And you know, Jake, that's key. It was fundamental football. He waited for his block, which we haven't seen all game. That's very key.
.10:50, and Steven, what did I say? One of our keys to the second half, who can cut down on penalties? And that huge play is coming back, completely wiped out of 50 yards. This is almost like a circus. Like, every big play after another on both sides just gets wiped out.
Jake, I can't help but chuckle anymore. 24 penalties in there. That is almost a penalty a minute, Jake, for this game. Jake, so, I mean, I don't know what you do if there's a penalty every minute in the game. That's on track for 48 penalties. That's ridiculous. I can't help but laugh.
Dominici's going to throw it in the flats to Brady, who drops the ball, and it'll be second down and eight now.
And, Jake, both teams, again, fundamental football. You got to make the catches. You can't hold on plays like that. So it's really key that they take this and they don't. Jake, I don't know what I'm seeing right here right now. I'm laughing, and I don't even know why, because this is not funny.
So second down and eight for the Mustangs. Dominici lining up. Two receivers on the right. He's got a tight end flank on the left, and it's going to be a pitch to Brady, who will take it across. He gets flipped over. There's a ball on the turf. The flag has flown. Excuse me, the marking flag, not a penalty flag. And that is Regis football. Regis will take over the ball on the Mullen 49-yard line. Steven, just like that, a great turn of events.
And if the Raiders score here, Jake, it is just like a 0-0 game. I think Raiders having momentum gives them about a touchdown worth of points.
What a fortunate turn of events for the Raiders. Just 30 seconds ago, the ball was about on the 5-yard line, and possibly Mullen was on the doorstep of a touchdown, but just like that, Regis Jesuit comes back out on offense. Hotelling leading out the troops. 10:20 to go in the third quarter. Hotelling, receiver on each side, Robert Orban going from left to right. Hotelling, now man in motion, the far right receiver. It's going to be a handoff off the middle to Jalen Williams. Jalen Williams gets maybe 1 yard.
And Jake, you see the Raiders here. I think the key for the Raiders here is not to get a touchdown, but get points. get it in the inside the distance of Harrison Thrasher, Vince Saban for the kick. So I really think that if the Raiders get points here, they're right back in this game.
Second and 9 for the Raiders on the Mullen 48-yard line. Hotalin going to line up under center again. That looks like Chase Bertinelli flanking the left tight end. Two receivers on the left side. Looking for some signals from the sidelines. Mullen lining up. Four men up front. There is a stoppage of play. That's a timeout. Regis, Steven, you never like to burn a timeout that early in a half, so I wonder what happened there.
Jake, I'm happy it wasn't a delay of game flag there, because having a delay of game penalty there was just not worth it. And I think this drive is so key that you don't like to burn a timeout, but you feel that burning timeout is still okay.
So here on second down and 9, we'll see if possibly the Raiders will try to give Hotaling the green light to throw, or if they'll stick with the routine running dosage. Once again, folks, Mullen up 14-0 with two good touchdowns in the first half. Regis had a chance at the end of the first half, but Hotaling's last-second pass was intercepted by Kevin Rayfield.
And, you know, Jake, I think the Raiders here, you're definitely going to look for a pass from Hotaling, I want to say, because he has been throwing it so well. He's aired the ball out 10-plus times this game, which is more than we've seen in all the other games combined, so it's really key.
Ball on the 48, second and 9. 9:36 to go in the third quarter. Raiders line up. 5 men up front. Hotaling going to throw to Williams, and Williams will get a yard at most, third and long.
And we'll see what the Raiders do here. Great play by Hotaling, though, or at least great thinking. The execution wasn't quite there, so we'll see. But the Raiders definitely picking up some momentum and just gaining some yards, and that's the key, is baby steps, Jake, baby steps.
Right you are, Steven. Third and 7 for the Raiders. Hotaling. And it's going to be a handoff up the middle. That did not work, so it'll be fourth down from the Mullen 47. Steven, punt or go?
Jake, go. I know it seems rash, but go. This is crucial.
So we're going to see what's going on now. Hotaling staying out. That looks to be three receivers on the left side. Trips right. Trips left. Hotaling's going to roll to the left side for 7 yards to make. The pass to the left side, incomplete. And that is a turnover on downs for the Raiders, Steven. So just like that, four plays, they gained about 3 yards. Not the best offensive drive of the night.
You know, Jake, it wasn't, but it was an improvement on pass drives. And I think that's really key, is just making steps forward and getting the ball going. So this is absolutely fantastic here. We'll see what the Raiders' defense can do here. Had some fantastic plays, forced 3 turnovers now, which is really key. So we'll see if they can maybe force another one here, Jake, for a 4th turnover and another good field position.
Right you are, Steven. Dominici lining up in an I formation, 1st and 10. Handoff to Brady. Brady's got a lot of room up the middle, bouncing off Regis tacklers for 11 yards and a 1st down.
And it seems like Mullen has a similar running game to the original Regis game plan, Jake. He is just so powerful, and they just run him up the middle time after time. And really, the Raiders have nothing to stop it, because Eddie Gonzalez and Antonio Brown is really off their game without Grant Neal on that left end.
Yeah, Grant Neal, it's important to remember, not only lost on the offensive side, but he played both sides. It's really like losing 2-star players, Steven, because you lose 2 key guys on each side of the ball.
And it really is, Jake. We'll see what Mullen does here. Looks like he's going to pass, but I could definitely see a run here.
Dominici going to fake handoff and do a little screen pass to number 1. That's Michael Moore. It is dropped. Pass a little low, but should have been caught. And Mullen has had success with those short screens as of late.
And, Jake, they've had success with them yards-wise, but that's only when they can catch them. They've dropped 3 or 4 of those in the game and caught 3 or 4. So it's really what we see a lot from Mullen is risk-taking. And it's a lot of risk reward. They've had a lot of setbacks, but they also had a lot of rewards in their 14 points. So we'll see if they continue this risk-taking or they tone it down into fundamental football, Jake.
So it'll be 2nd down and 10. Dominici leading the troops to the line. in a – he's going to be in a little bit of a pistol, yeah, kind of a midway between a shotgun and under center. And he's going to do a shovel pass up the middle. We do not see that often, but to Connor Brady, a little shovel pass, that is technically a pass because it was forward. But a nice play call by the Mustangs to move the chains.
And, you know, Jake, that was fantastic. Domenici really recognized the coverage there and executed. It didn't look like it was really a design play, but it definitely was thrown in there. And the Mullen play calling has just become fantastic this second half, Jake.
So the chains are moving even further now. Looks to be some sort of late penalty, Steven, on the Raiders. 15 more yards and roughing the passer. So the discipline on behalf of the Regis Jesuit Raiders has been pretty pitiful. 7:35 left to go in the third quarter. Mullen now with the ball on the Regis Jesuit 22. Domenici going to look right and overthrows his man, number 14, Ryan Gomer Dinger, the senior 5'9 wide receiver.
And, you know, that really is key, Jake. Mullen, as you said, the Regis defense, or discipline, excuse me, pitiful. And I think that's really the only words they can use to describe that. It is pitiful. 14 penalties. That's absolutely ridiculous, Jake. I mean, there's only been about 35 minutes of play. That's a penalty every 2.5 minutes.
Domenici going to hand off to Brady, who tries to do the old Xbox B spin move. Will get caught. Does not work. But a quick tangent, Steven. I did see, if you watched the Rutgers-USF game yesterday, the Rutgers running back just made a perfect spin move. It was just video game quality.
I actually did see that, Jake, and that was a fantastic play. We'll see here. I'm amazed that Brady got any yards on that play, Jake. He looked like he was definitely down in the backfield and managed to squeak out a gain of a couple yards there.
So it'll be third down and 9. Domenici going to drop back. He's looking left. He's going to throw a little fade up in the end zone, jump ball, batted away for the Raiders. And now we will see if Mullen has faith in their kicker to kick a 35-yard field goal.
And for Domenici, Jake, for as good as he is, I really haven't seen him make the smartest decisions throughout this game. It's really concerning for Mullen, and every time he throws, I think the Mullen's coaching staff heart stops a little.
I agree, Steven, and this will be a 33-yard field goal. The hold is good, the snap good, the kick is up. It looks a little right. It is right, no good. Break by Regis, it had the distance, but it is wide right, and just like that, the Raiders will take over with the ball on the 27-yard line.
And Jake, that reminds me of a little today when we were doing a physics lab where we had to kick some field goals. Most of them went wide right.
Funny how those things work. All in the name of science. And the music is playing. 6:40 to go in the third quarter. Really imperative that the Raiders put some points on the board because, as so far, all these drives have been for nothing.
We'll see here, Jake.
Here's Hotelling. He's going to fake handoff. He's rolling out to the right. Got a man, and it's intercepted. No, it was not intercepted. He dropped the interception, but Hotelling really should have thrown the ball to Orban there, Steven.
He really should have, Jake, and I think the Raiders starting to having to think a little too big because they are concerned about the clock coming into effect here in a couple of minutes and really pressuring them. I mean, they shouldn't have to, but it seems like they're playing that way, Jake.
I agree, Steven. Hotelling struggling lately. Shaw in motion. Hotelling going to hand it off to Jalen Williams. Jalen Williams trying to make some men miss. Steven, this offense is really struggling.
And, you know, Jake, I think Regis might need to take on some advice from Mullen here and maybe take a little more risk. I mean, they're usually just a fundamental solid team, but that's not working today. I think they need to take a couple more risks, throw a little more of those deep balls, see if they can maybe even get some flags.
Yeah, I mean, really, four things can happen when you throw the ball. It can be completed, there can be a flag, or it can fall incomplete or get picked off. Two of them are good. And here's Hotelling. He doesn't know what to do. He's going to try to scramble. And a good effort for a couple of yards, but the Raiders will still be 5 yards short of a first down.
And I think as a young quarterback, Jake, you really have to keep in the mind what your situation is. He can't be scrambling there against this run-heavy stopper Mullen defense. He has to throw that and at least give themselves a chance for a first down.
So Sebastian Harris getting a lot of work tonight. Not usually a good thing when your punter is out so much, but we'll see if Sebastian can try to help the Raiders win the field position battle here. 5:17 left in the third quarter. Low snap. Sebastian's punt is low, too. It hit a Mullen player's back. It's live. There's a big collision for it right off the back of an unsuspecting Mustang blocker, but I think Mullen hopped on it.
Mullen is going to get the ball, Jake, but if you're the Raiders, they saw that, and I think if you're running downfield to tackle the kicker.
Yes.
Sorry about that. But we'll see here what Regis can do. Mullen, again, fantastic field position, Jake, and they just get another opportunity here to really succeed.
So a very dangerous play for the Mustangs that fortunately they recovered the ball. Unfortunate for the Raiders, and it's a pitch to, that's number 9, Patrick Healy. Healy's got a lane, and he'll tiptoe get tossed out at around the Regis Jesuit 40. So on one end, in the second half, Mullen really having no problem moving the ball. They're moving the ball at ease, and Regis really struggling.
And, Jake, that's the fourth time Mullen has taken one play to get into Regis territory this game. So Raiders really happy with the score right now, but you know they'd like to get some points on the board. Because getting on the board is really key, Jake. See here, run by Mullen. Healy again. There's a flag. Our 27th flag of the game.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
I mean, I...
25th.
25th. Conservative, but... It's a bad game, really, if your team commits more than 8 fouls, I'd say, Steven. And, I mean, this is just a new definition of bad penalty discipline. Holding on Mullen, the blame falls both ways. Both teams really struggling to make simple legal plays.
And, you know, Jake, as I mentioned at the start of this half, the teams that does go back to fundamental football, just not committing penalties, will win this game because with the fouls committed last half, these teams have 150 more yards of play.
Yes, even without a doubt, both sides leaving a ton of yards on the table. Dominici, fake handoff, pass to Moore, but that would have been for about nothing. So it'll be second down and 14 to go from the Regis Jesuit 48. Folks, thanks for joining us. We've got a pretty big audience now, so kudos to all of you. 86. Count yourself lucky if you're in that. Dominici dropping back. He's going to look left down the middle, and that was a nice pass.
Let's I don't know if it's going to be enough, Jake.
That's number 3, Casey Miller, but that was only second down, Steven. So.
Oh, that's true. I didn't even consider that, Jake. We'll see here what the Raiders can do on this short defense. I imagine we'll see Mullen's big running back, number 36 here, Brady, with the ball just up the middle.
And indeed, it's a run up the middle with more than enough for a Mullen first down. So with 4 minutes to go in the third half, Mullen has a first down at the Regis Jesuit 25-yard line.
Indeed, Jake. And I think if Mullen doesn't come away with points here, they're going to be really disappointed.
Yeah, Steven, I dare say if Mullen comes away with a touchdown here, this would almost put the game out of reach.
And it really would, Jake. I don't think he would completely end it, but it would crush the Raiders.
Dominici going to pitch it. That's Healy. Healy taking it across the 20. Steven, they've done that exact play, I think, like 7 or 8 times this game.
And the key, Jake, is that Dominici, because he does have an arm, you got to watch for the play action deep throw. And that's why it's been so successful, is because they've managed to make him a dual threat quarterback, even though his arm hasn't been great tonight.
So 3:19 now. Dominici lining up his Mustang offense. Two receivers to the left. Regis lining up. Three men front, but it's going to be a blitz on the right side. Healy's going to run it. He's going to hop his way to the 10-yard line, and that's a big gain for Mullen, and that will set them up with first down and goal.
And this is where Regis' defense really earns its keep, Jake, is inside the goal line. But, well, it'll be interesting to see what they do here because their kicker already has missed the kick. So we'll see what happens here, but we'll see if the Raiders can keep it out of the end zone, Jake.
First end goal from the 9-yard line. Dominici got two receivers left in an I formation. Dominici, he fumbled the ball. He'll fall on it. But that puts Mullen back to the 19-yard line.
And, Jake, second and goal from the 19 is not what you want if you're Mullen. But it definitely puts some questions in your head. I imagine he'll have to throw it. So very nervous moments for the Mullen coaching staff, I imagine, Jake.
Yeah, it looked like a mishandled exchange on that, Steven. But the Raiders will more than take it. Now it's important to see if Regis can get some good pass coverage, pressure the quarterback, focus on not giving up a big chunk of yards. Dominici looking left. He's going to throw up a fade to the end zone. It's up, and it is incomplete. No flags on the field. Nice coverage.
And that's one place we really have seen discipline, Jake, is in the Raiders' pass coverage. They've definitely done a very good job of getting the coverage they need without fouling. So props to them, Jake.
Yes, Steven, I do give it two thumbs up for the Regis defensive back so far. A nice interception by J.J. Kilgore. And there was another interception in the first half. Number 32. So now, third and 19. He's going to do a wide receiver screen to Brady. Missed tackle. Brady will dance his way into the end zone. A missed tackle at around the 15. But that is a killer punch in the gut. Mullen now up 20-0.
Third and 18, Jake. You cannot let them in the end zone. Fundamental mistake by the Raiders. And, folks, just got word from our producer, Tommy Raines. We are now over 100 viewers. So thank you for tuning in to this fantastic game. It has been an exciting game.
Do not leave. This game will get better. The extra point is up and good. Ladies and gentlemen, Nebraska came back from 21 against Ohio State last year. It is possible. Stay tuned. We're going to take a short break, but we'll be right back. So with less than 2 minutes to go in the third quarter, Mullen is up 21-0. Welcome back to Brother Bernard Kinnevy De La Salle Stadium on the campus of Mullen High School. Steven, we've had an awesome time so far. A big thank you to Mullen for hosting us in their press box. And with the kickoff is number 15, John Scott. Scott's kick is high, and Will Dines to field it from about the 2-yard line. Dines going to bring it out in the middle, go left, try to make it to the sideline. And there is a hold on number 17, A.J. Shaw. A.J. Shaw trying to get away with something there, but he was caught.
Interesting, Jake. The ref didn't throw the flag on the hold. We all saw it. The Mullen crowd started yelling hold, and then the flag went. So if this is a holding call, it'd be very interesting because the ref threw that way after the hold occurred.
So we'll wait to see what the official call is. It is holding on the Raiders. Steven, that is the
15th
penalty on Regis Jesuit during this game. Needless to say, that's not good. And Regis will start this drive within their own 10-yard line. It's never good to start on your own 20, but...
And, Jake, that is actually 145 yards in penalties, which is a touchdown and a half. And on most times, that can account for two whole drives of scoring that the Raiders have negated in penalties.
Without a doubt, Steven. Hotelling, we're going to see if he can air it out. Trips right. Man left. Mullen, five men up. Actually, they're in kind of a 3-1-2 early. DBs under kind of in an umbrella. It's a quick pass, number four. That's John Schmidt. John Schmidt. So, you know what? I like that pass because that gives Hotelling some confidence, Steven.
That does, Jake. And I think if you're the Raiders, the key is just getting first downs. You really can't risk it and air it out here because whatever happens, you just can't risk it. You got to keep the ball here. You got to play solidly, and you got to get points.
The temperature is 68 degrees on this beautiful Friday night. Hotelling's going to hand off up the middle, and that is a first down for Regis Jesuit. So, Steven, I think that's the first down that Regis has had this half.
I actually believe that's true, Jake, and that is key. Just getting fundamentally sound and solid yards for the Raiders. At least they're moving the ball and doing something, Jake.
Without a doubt, Steven, very promising start to this drive. Hotelling, three receivers on the left side. Mullen, get a rush, five. Hotelling looking over the middle to Elliott, overthrew his man. There's a flag, and that is roughing the passer. These Mullen defenders just cannot lay their hands off. Steven, correct me if I'm wrong. Is that the third roughing the passer penalty
it
on
is,
Mullen?
Jake. Three roughing the passer penalties. That is 45 yards of plays that usually are gain no yards. So giving the Raiders free yards here, we'll see if they can do anything with it. That brings our penalty total to 27, which is now six higher than the score of our teams combined, Jake. That's got to be concerning for the coaches.
Well, six higher than the score of Mullen, too. But we'll see if the Regis Jesuit can work on that penalty and first down. There's a stoppage of play. So, Steven, so far, what would you say you're most pleased with of Regis, if anything?
I definitely think for Regis, I'm most pleased with their confidence in their team, their confidence in Hotelling, their confidence in their defense. Despite their play, they are maintaining fantastic confidence in everything, Jake. And I think that's really key for the mentality of the players.
Well said, Steven. Regis will have the ball first and 10 on the 36. Trips to the right side. Hotelling going to scramble out to the right side. He's going to throw down the field to DeJure Elliott. That's a nice pass. Gain of about 15 for a first down, Regis.
And you know what I think the key to that play, Jake, is? If you look at the very end of the play, the real key is that the Raiders are now in Mustang territory. So that's really key, Jake.
Under 1 minute to go, 46 seconds left. Regis Jesuit down 21-0, but this looks like a promising drive. Three receivers left, and there's a flag on the play. And some tussling going on after the play with number 55. But, Steven, I believe this will be number 17 on the Raiders.
And, Jake, to that flag, I say, why not? Let's just toss another. This is really false start on the Raiders. Hooray. That'll take us back another 5 yards. Now at 28 and counting.
Yeah, I mean, really, when you talk about discipline and a lack of discipline, your first thought is the Oakland Raiders. And the Regis Jesuit Raiders really haven't been that far. This was a really promising drive, so let's hope that Matt Hotelling can salvage the drive, even with that 5-yard penalty. Hotelling gonna scramble out to the left side now. He's looking down the field to Elliott, and the pass goes incomplete. That's a pretty hard catch by Elliott, I'd say, Steven.
And I think Hotelling has confidence in him, though, Jake, because he is really giving he's giving Elliott a lot of passes coming off the field here, so we'll see what they're doing. But second and 15, Jake, from the looks of it. So we'll see if the Raiders can continue this drive strong and get some points on the board.
10 seconds left to go in the third quarter, second and 15. Hotelling lining up, two receivers on the right, one on the left. Mullen with looking maybe to blitz from the outsides. Robert Orban moving over from right to left. Hotelling looking right over the middle to number 16. Falls incomplete. Hotelling looks like some miscommunication with him and his receivers.
Definitely, Jake, but I saw a fundamentally sound throw there, and if they can connect on that West Coast-style passing, it's very effective against almost any defense, Jake, especially with Hotelling rolling out and giving himself some more time.
6.3 seconds left to go, Steven, and we'll see. It's third and very long, third and 15. Hotelling almost forced to pass here. Orban and one more Raider receiver on the left side. Man on the right. Hotelling's going to pitch to Bertinelli, and the ball is loose. The ball will be picked up by number 8 of the Mustangs, and that trick play completely backfired. Touchdown, Mullen, and it's 27-0 at the end of three quarters.
And, Jake, think about it. If Mullen makes this PAT, they have officially tied with their points the number of penalties we have seen this game.
I think that's almost as sad as the fact that Regis has pretty much handed Mullen every touchdown that they've scored based on poor plays, tipping a ball that could have been intercepted, not wrapping up people on the ground. And the result is a 27-0 score with no seconds remaining in the third quarter. There's the referees are conversing on the far side of the field, so we'll see what this is about.
I don't think they're discussing the fumble. That was clearly a fumble. Oh, it was a forward pass, Jake. Oh, but it is ruled a touchdown, so that will be a fumble. Regis sending out its block team. Jake, do you think the Raiders can come back, or do they not have the drive to do it?
Well, Steven, honestly, my heart wants to say yes, but in reality, I think the Raiders have a pretty slim chance of coming back just because of how inefficient the offense has been looking. And even if the Raiders are successful in offense, the reality is the Regis offense is a slow tempo, pounded out running offense. Steven, this does not look good. But crazier things have happened. It's going to be tough. 4 touchdowns in 12 minutes. Not impossible, but not probable.
And, you know, Jake, it's really disappointing when a play like that happens. You have such a key drive, and then it's just gone in a flash. So I think the Raiders need to start just taking risks, letting Hotelling air it out and hoping for pass interference penalties. Mullen does have 4 of those out of their 12 penalties committed today. So
we're going to take a quick break here on RJ Live, but we'll be right back for the exciting conclusion of this close game. And welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to our final quarter of play here with Regis Jesuit and Mullen. Off to kick off for the Mullen Mustangs is number 11, Marcus Harrison. Harrison with his sprint. It's a good kick. Will Dines will field it on about the 2, running it out across the 10-yard line. He's going to be across the 20. Steven.
A flag, Jake, another flag.
We apologize for our utter cynicism, but it really is amazing to see how often a team really can be penalized. If we had a stat, some sort of saber metrics about the number of plays run without a flag, I bet it would be far below 50% of total plays.
Jake, this is getting out of hand for the Raiders. 17 flags in one game. That is unexcusable. And, Jake, I honestly feel like when the Raiders show up to practice on Monday, I feel there's going to be a lot of running.
Yeah, normally I would say that discipline has been a positive of the Raiders in years past. Not tonight at all. And once again, the Raiders will start a drive deep, 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 deep within their own territory on their own six. So Hotelling's going to scramble out to the left side. Hotelling looking for some room. Going to throw a cross of body to Elliott, who tries to make a nice catch with his feet. The referee rules he is out of bounds.
And, Jake, that's the risk they need to be taking, though, getting open and getting passes downfield. I really think that the Raiders just need to air one out here, Jake. I don't think there's any other response. Just take a long throw and hope for the best.
So, Steven, right now, 11:46 left to go in the fourth quarter of play. Once again, Mullen up 28-0 in Regis Jesuit. Here's Hotelling, trips left. Looks like Hotelling will get some good passing practice. And, nope, it'll be a handoff for about nothing.
And, Jake, as I think more and more about the flag situation, I really wonder if these teams are committing all these penalties. Not to say anything bad about the refs, but they seem to maybe be a little flag happy.
My producer, Tommy Raines, would like me to reference the NFL referees and the fact that they are replacements. I guess he's making a comparison between their quality and the quality of these referees indirectly, which is something we would never do. We would never criticize referees. I think these referees are fine. I just think these teams, especially Regis, has made some awful decisions. And there's another run that will go for nothing.
Jake, I know it sounds crazy, 3rd and 8 on your own 9, but I think the Raiders have to go for it. I don't think there's any other option to win this game. Doesn't look like they will, but I think they had to go for it here.
Steven, at this point, I think you have to accept the reality of defeat. Hopefully just try to improve your team in some game situations against an elite team. And let's face it, if anything this game has taught us, that Regis is not at the level that Mullen is and at the level of other state contenders this year.
And we'll see, Jake, maybe with healthier players and some better situations, they could be competing in this game. But discipline was really the key, Jake, in their downfall. And I'm not afraid to say it with you. I believe this game is over.
So Sebastian will be punting from the end zone. I believe that's a delay of game. So, I mean, really, Steven,
Why not, Jake?
Can't keep putting this on the players. I have to put these on the coaches for just making these terrible, just, I don't know if they're just setting up the team for failure, but, I mean, come on.
Jake.
Yeah, a couple penalties are on the players, but when you have a system that just commits penalty after penalty, that's coaching.
And, Jake, I think with... I think with 18 penalties, Jake, you do have to consider it be part of the coaches. So we'll see here. Punt there for about, what was that, 20 yards, Jake? 20-yard net punt, maybe?
Yeah, I think that was about 20 yards. And I do want to qualify. I'm not talking about the overall quality of our coaches. And anyway, I'm just saying that this game, it's unfair to blame all penalties on the players. Clearly some coaching needs to be improved in terms of discipline and make sure that the kids can be set up for success instead of all these delay of game penalties. Because really, there's no clock in high. There's no snap clock in high school. You really have to communicate with the players that the play clock's getting low, but there's a personal foul on Mullen. So it seems like, if anything, Steven, I'd say Regis has just been making just overly, like, just stupid, like, holding false start penalties, whereas Mullen has just been super aggressive, like caveman, just smash, roughing, just aggressive personal fouls.
And, Jake, for those of you playing at home, that's 31 now penalties for the game. Really concerning.
Amanichi going for the artery. He's got number one down the field. It is caught. Nope, it's incomplete. Dominici trying to go to Michael Moore for the slice to the jugular to kill the Raiders. Thankfully, that falls incomplete. Steven, that looked really close to being a completion.
That really was, Jake. And to emphasize the importance of this game, I saw a couple past Raiders who come down from Regis University actually to watch this game. Shout out to them, Harrison Herb. I know Ross Heath was here. I see Michael Cates, so definitely some support here, but I don't think the Raiders could pull together for him tonight, Jake.
Well, there's still 9:58 left on the clock. Brady gets smashed, and there will be a flag. There will be a flag. More flags on the field. Tensions are rising. A late hit on the Mullen. Steven, that was a late hit against Regis. Another flag. They're throwing hats. They're throwing flags. This is bedlam. This is
absolutely
unbelievable.
I really think we need to see how many flags are out here, because we could be at 36 or 37 flags here with this. That was a late hit. And, Jake, what I didn't like about that hit was it was purely helmet to helmet. You could hear it. And the safety of players is key. I did not like that hit by the Raiders. That shows poor sportsmanship and poor discipline.
I completely agree with you 100%, Steven. That was very inappropriate on behalf of the Raider that committed that. The runner, that was Brady, was clearly out of bounds. Very malicious intent. The intent was to injure. You just can't have that. And I think that's a culmination of a lot of frustrations tonight for Regis. But in the end, you got to be punished for that. And once again, this is just, I mean, honestly, I know that Regis has, Mullen scored on some lucky penalties, but this is one of the worst performances I've seen all around in a while.
It really is, Jake, and we'll see how many penalties there are. I believe he just said five personal fouls on each team that negate. So that brings us up to 41 penalties for the game. So they negate each other, but 10 penalties on one play, Jake. You really don't like to see that when tensions are this high.
So what does that bring our total up to?
41. 41, Jake.
You know, I will say that I feel like that's a little like the referee, it's just kind of very subjective about how he can just decide to call five on each team. But whatever, we go with it. It's high school football. Dominici lining up on a shotgun, twin receivers on each side, and he's going to pass it to number 80, who will take it out. Not going to be enough for a first down. But with the Mullen anger towards the Regis Jesuit Raiders, I would not be surprised if they go for it here.
And you know, Jake, you hate to see respect run out of a high school football game. That's all. And we saw before the game with all the co-divisional ceremonies. We even had a food drive that the schools combined in, the upperclassmen versus the lowerclassmen from each school. And there was not much bad blood coming into this, but as the game progresses, it seems to grow, Jake.
So Dominici will indeed go for it in an I formation. Get a handoff to Brody. He dropped the ball. Dominici falls on it. I'm not sure. He could have tried to pick it up, but that's the second time that happened. So Regis Jesuit will get the ball on the 50-yard line.
And I think, Jake, for the Raiders, they do still have a chance with this field position if they take it and they bomb it deep. That's all they have here, Jake. They need to come out the first play hoteling to either Elliott or Alex Mitchell or Robert Orban and just get a deep pass down there and get points on the board.
9:15 to go in the fourth quarter. Once again, Mullen up 28-0. This game has become very ugly as of late. I honestly believe that the ref called five personal fouls on each team. So hoteling, and I would say Stephen hoteling, he's performed probably about the same as his other games. I haven't seen a whole lot of improvement. A little more short passes, but we'll see now. Hoteling, three trips. Trips to the left side. Hoteling going to hand off to Bertinelli. Bertinelli pressing the B. We'll take it across the 40-yard line for a first down, Raiders.
And, Jake, that's what you like to see, the power running from the Raiders. I do think Hoteling's confidence is up and his risk-taking is up. And I like both those things, Jake. I'd love to see confidence. I'd love to see risk-taking. So even though we haven't seen improvement in skills, we've seen improvement in his quarterbacking overall.
Good analysis, Steven. 9 minutes to go. Hoteling going to scramble out left, looking deep down the field, up to Elliott. Steven, one comment I would like to make is I feel like these outlet passes on the left require very, very precise timing, catching ability, and a really accurate pass. And I feel like those three things really make it difficult to complete them.
And I think, Jake, the only reason they do it is to give Hoteling time. He has had tons of time today, which is key for the Raiders with this ferocious Mullen defensive line, and we haven't seen maybe more rollouts from Mullen. Timeout Mullen. Oh, it's an injured player. No, it's not.
Yeah, there's an injured Mullen player on the Regis Jesuit sideline, so we hope that he's all right. You know, in the end, this absolutely is just a game, so prayers to him. We need to make sure that the player's health is always at the utmost priority. And, you know, in the end, both these schools, both these fine institutions of high school learning have the same goals in the end. And really, we try to put it in perspective of everything overall, but we hope that he's okay. He's still down on the far sideline.
And Jake, I believe that was the player that hopped over Elliot when Elliot missed the catch. And I think he might have slipped on the track and maybe hit his head or slipped and hurt his back. Jake, I'd like to give one more shout out to the man playing this music. Now have Jump On It playing, and man, fantastic song.
And ladies and gentlemen, I would like to give some shout outs right now. Shane Madigan wanted me to get him on at some time. A shout out to the tennis team, if anyone on the tennis team is listening. We had an awesome party today. Thank you to Mrs. Abbott and Mr. Abbott for hosting us at their home. And everyone, if you can wish some luck for the Regis tennis team tomorrow competing at the Cherry Creek Invitational. That'll be a big day for us.
Shout out to all the teams, the Jesuit Classic, Marquette, Gonzaga, Regis, and Rockhurst, who are playing in a sock tournament this weekend, which we'll actually see you tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. because we are broadcasting that game. And a shout-out to Mr. Dawkins, our moderator, who helps make all of this possible for us and really gives us a chance to broadcast all these games.
Yeah, Mr. Dawkins, instrumental and essential to our success, so we thank him. And the injured player is number 4, Nigel Vaughns. He's walking off on his own power. That's great to see. The senior DB, 5'9". We don't want to see any injuries, and he looks to be fine on the sideline. Perhaps got his wind knocked out. So here's Hotelling. 2nd and 10 on the 39-yard line with 8:54 to go in the fourth quarter. That's Bertinelli in the backfield. Hotelling going to look for a quick pass to the right, and it's intercepted. That route was jumped. That's number 9, Patrick Keeley, taking it to the house. Patrick Keeley playing both sides. Completely jumped that route. Oh, ho, baby.
Game over, Jake. There is no way Regis is coming back from this. That'll be game over. They read that perfectly. Healy, a dual threat like Grant Neal on both sides of the ball there, getting that interception, and with tremendous speed, taking it to the house. Touchdown, Mullen. I think that seals it, Jake.
Steve and I think this game has been sealed almost half an hour ago. But we can say that that is the final nail in the coffin of many nails. 34-0 with 8:44 to go.
And Jake, what I really...
Another flag. There are 2 flags on the play, Steven. Sorry to interrupt you. But I think really at this point, we need to make sure that no one gets hurt. We're going to take a quick break and bring you right back to this game after we sort this stuff out.
Welcome back, everybody. Glad to have you.
So after that, it seems to be there were some late hits on Mullen because they will be kicking off from the 25. So the Raiders don't know that they have to move up, but they have to move up to set up on the 35-yard line. They can't go in front of that. Again, Steven, I would like to say Mullen definitely being the aggressive kind of enforcers. They've been having so many late personal fouls. And Regis just making stupid delay of game, holding, sort of, you know, false start, just bad formation stuff. But here's Harrison to kick off. It'll bounce and be fielded by, that's Chase Bertinelli. He'll take it across the 30, and he'll take it across the 35 out of bounds.
And Jake, these plays going all the way to the whistle. Both teams still playing their hearts out. Penalty totals for both teams now, 23 for Regis, 19 for Mullen. And I think if Mullen gets one more and we reach 20 for each team, Jake, it is going – that's. Do we have the CHSAA rule book on hand to check this?
We should. We'll get on that, Steven. Matt Hotelling's still out. Steven, has he thrown two or three picks? One or the other.
Two, Jake.
Okay, so
both quarterbacks have two.
Hand off to Williams. A little late scrum there. No flag on that. His forward progress was stopped, but you're never going to flag a team for carrying out a play. It'll be second down and 10 now.
Jake, I think Raiders just need to air it out. Get Elliott on the far sideline and just air it out. Just take a deep shot at the end zone. That's all they have left running for him.
Second and 10, 8:06 left. Hotelling scrambling right. He could run it, and he's going to pass it instead to DeJure Elliott. A nice pitch and catch for 15 yards, and that'll bring the Raiders across midfield. Oh, nope. Excuse me, that was incomplete. I thought that was complete, Steven.
I saw him even stutter step, Jake. I don't know about that call. But we'll see. I think this is reminding me of the state championship game a couple years back, Jake, where Mullen just absolutely took control and kind of clobbered the Raiders.
Yeah, Steven. That's a sad analogy that we don't like to talk about, but seems pretty accurate so far. Hotelling's going to pitch it to Jalen Williams, who will fall. Steven, if we had a stats guy tonight, I don't know if Regis has gained positive yards overall.
And definitely with penalties, Jake, I don't think they have. But we'll see. It's definitely in the low double digits.
Yeah, this Raider offense has looked very shell-struck, star-struck, whatever the word is, against this Mullen.
Flag, and we're now at 20 and 23, Jake.
So there's a personal foul face mask against Mullen. I believe that's at least the 10th personal foul against Mullen. You know, we're not at all judging the refs. I think the refs are doing what they have to and enforcing what's a pretty rough game. But this has just gotten out of hand. So Hotelling now is going to line up. We're 7:30 to play. Three receivers left. Hotelling's going to hand off to Bertinelli. Bertinelli will fight for 3 yards.
And Jake, looking at this game, I think I've got to commend the Raiders for even coming out here and playing, because they really don't have anything. They don't have anything to play for. Playing for pride mainly here, but it's got to be tough to just get out on this field right now, Jake, when you're getting so beaten up so badly.
Yeah, a lot of perseverance and tenacity for the Raiders. So Talling's going to hand it off. That's Bertinelli. Bertinelli fighting his way forward for about 15 yards and a Regis Jesuit first down.
And Jake, Bertinelli really a bright spot, having a decent amount of great runs this game. Gaining, I think Bertinelli actually is the one carrying the Raiders into positive yardage. So really a bright spot for the Raiders. And if there's anything positive to take away from this game, it's definitely that Bertinelli can carry this team.
So here's Hotelling from the Mullen 37. Hotelling's going to do a quick pass to the right. Flag on the play. Steven, I would seriously bet money that of all total plays, many more than 50% of them have had flags on the play.
I can't imagine we've run more than 88 plays, Jake, so I would have to agree with you, because that is the 44th flag of the game. And, Jake, you think we'll hit 50?
Do not doubt anything. I think we could have another scrum, perhaps, bad blood boiling. Ineligible receiver downfield. So, Steven, that's where those are really formation penalties where I see Mullen's penalties. You can make a strong case that those are on the players because of the aggression, but I mean, these are formation stuff. This is delay a game, illegal formation, illegal man downfield. You know, I don't know how much this young team can really do about that stuff.
And I think, excuse me, Jake, I think you really have to look at the frustration of the Raiders contributing to this.
John Schmidt down the sideline, and he caught it. Touchdown, Raiders. Hotelling to Schmidt. 41 yards to the house. And And with 6:33 left, the score is Regis Jesuit 6, Mullen 35.
And for the first time, Jake, in about 2 hours, I can finally hear the Regis Jesuit crowd on their feet screaming, giving them a little hope. And that's why the Raiders, that answered my question on how they can still come out here, Jake. They still have hope. They still have perseverance. And with 6:33, the game still might be out of reach, but they can still play for pride, Jake.
Flag on the play. Two flags. Three flags. I see three flags on the field right now.
Jake, give me a moment. These flags are almost becoming comical to me.
Yeah, I mean, I
think this could be placed at least slightly on flag happy.
Delay
refs.
Game on Mullen. Personal foul. Aggression on Mullen. So, yeah, I mean, Steven, this is just a hideous game. Like, in all honesty, it's not even well played.
And now these teams are at 23 fouls apiece, Jake. 46 flags total.
Harrison Thrasher into a kick the extra point. Steven, on a lighter note, did Regis win the Jesuit Classic game today? Thrasher's kick is up.
I do not know, Jake.
And good.
I had to come over here before the game was over to get this set up, but I know that Rockhurst did lose 2-1 to Marquette, and Gonzaga was playing the Raiders. When I left, it was 0-0 about halfway through the first half, so about a quarter way through the game, Jake. So we'll see. I imagine, Jake, do you think the Raiders will go for an onside kick here?
You know, Steven, really nothing to lose. I feel like this late in the game, you might want to just kick it deep. But, you know, I think it is important to practice onside kicks, so I think that would be a very understandable decision by Nolan. And we want to remind everyone, next weekend, Regis Jesuit is home against, I believe, Dakota Ridge. No, Chatfield?
Chatfield.
You sure?
50%.
It's either Chatfield or Dakota Ridge. I know it's one of those two. But should be a pretty good game. I checked Max Preps, and they're both pretty evenly ranked. They're both 2-0 so far, and Regis will kick the ball deep. Number 36, Brady, to receive it, and it will bounce into the end zone, very close to being out of bounds, but a touchback.
Interesting fact, Jake, actually, this is Mullen's worst starting field position of the game by about 14 yards. So their other worst starting field position besides this is their 34-yard line, so we'll see if Regis can do something with this. Maybe a quick pick or a fumble, Jake, to get them back into this.
And here's Brady going to run it out. Some more late shoving between number 28, Shane Moody, and number 1, Michael Moore. No flag. At this point, really, Stephen, the only thing you have to play for is pride and basic human dignity.
Jake, we'll see here. I think they need a fumble or an interception, just a quick one, to at least give them a chance at winning this game, Jake. I still think it could be there with a turning play like an pick six. You said it was over.
Mullen lining up. And it's going to be handoff up the middle to Brady. Brady will run it out, a big gain. Looks to be very close to the first down. And that'll be just a tad short, so third and very short. But Dominici has played pretty well, I'd say, Steven.
And, you know, he's played well, Jake, but nothing like last week when we had, was it Stackhouse?
Yeah, Austin Stackhouse.
Austin Stackhouse, he played fantastically. I wouldn't call Dominici on the level of his, but he's played fundamentally sound.
Had a couple mishandled snaps. But Brady will take it across their own 35-yard line for a first down. We are just over 5 minutes to go in the fourth quarter. Once again, Mullen up 35-7 on the Raiders with 46 total penalties in this not the prettiest football game.
Jake, the only reason I'm critical of Domenici is he has mishandled a few snaps, but he also has two interceptions in this game. So we'll see what happens here.
So here's Domenici under center in an I formation, going to hand off to Brady up again. Brady powering up. So just a quick recap, folks. The game was scoreless after one quarter of play. In the second quarter, Brady had the ball from the Mullen own 45-yard line, went on a pretty solid run for about 10 yards. Excuse me, Steven corrected me. He's right. At the end of the first quarter, the last play, Stack Brady was tackled, but he fell on a Regis defender and was not touched, scored a touchdown uncontested. Second quarter, Mullen threw a pass from the Regis Jesuit 40, and it was tipped by a Regis defender, but the tip went right to number 9, Healy, and Healy took it inside the 10, inside the 5, where Mullen pounded it in with Brady. But after that, it was 14-0. That was the score at halftime, and since then, Mullen has just, when it rains, it pours. 4:10 to go, but a pick six interception. Mullen's done it all, Steven.
They really have, Jake, and they're such a dynamic team, and that's what makes them one of the top teams in Colorado year after year, is their three-dimensionalness, special teams, offense and defense, always there for Mullen.
Once again, Shane Moody and Moore getting into it. Those two don't look to be the best of friends. 3:50 to go in the final quarter of play. So here's here's Domenici now. Two receivers to the left. We'll expect them to just run. It'll be a pitch to Brady. Brady going to cut it in the 40-yard line, and there's a flag on Regis Jesuit, number 44, for kind of trying to rip the head off of Brady.
47, Jake, only three away from 50.
Excuse me,
might make it.
That is the backup running back for Mullen, Jesse Mangini, and that's a personal foul trying to rip the head off of Mangini by Declan Brown. So that's 15 more yards for Mullen. And 3:27 to go. So Mullen will have the ball on the Regis Jesuit 29-yard line.
All right, so.
So here comes Domenici lining up. We'll see if they just do the same play. Mangini going to get some reps for the Mustangs, and he's going to hand it off to the big man, number 44, who powering his way inside the 20-yard line. That's Adam Elbeck, the big 5'11", 220 senior.
And, you know, Jake, I think as the game winds down here with under 3 minutes to go, I think my player of the game, offense and defense, is the same person for Mullen. Number 9, Patrick Healy. He has touchdowns on both sides and has actually scored 21 of Mullen's 35 points.
Yeah, Patrick Healy with the pick six interception. And here's a handoff to Mangini. Mangini going to take it to the 10. And we're at 2:38 left to go in the fourth quarter. It's a first down, Mullen.
Jake, if I had to give a player of the game award to Regis, it'd be a tie between Sebastian Harris, who's actually punted fairly well tonight for the Raiders, or Chase Bertinelli, who's been the lone bright spot on the Regis offense.
Yeah, if anyone, I'll give player of the game to J.J. Kilgore for making a nice interception, and he had some nice tackles, but really I don't think anyone is really deserving. And it's going to be a handoff to the big man, 44, Elbeck. 2 minutes to go in the game.
And we'll see if Mullen scores again or if they just try to run out the clock. So taking their time. Really hope we don't break 50 penalties, Jake, and I don't think we will unless something erupts here.
So here's Dominici, and he's going to pass it to Mangini, who will take it to the 10, tackled by number 97. So that'll be third down, 1:27 to go. Michael Gunther on the tackle.
And that hit looked same place. So Gunther bring the ferocity. And, Jake, that hit looked like the exact same one that stripped Stackhouse last week and gave Will Dines that big run back, because Gunther did force the fumble last week. That was the same spot, same ferocity, and really at least some flashes from good from the Raiders in the winding down seconds.
Michael Gunther never gives up. Kudos to him for making a nice tackle pursuing the play. Hand off to number 25, and it'll be fourth down. So Mullen will have to either kick a field goal or go for it here. They don't have enough time to just let the clock run out. If I were to guess, they'd probably kick a field goal just to give their kicker some practice. No real point to try to run it and rub it in. I guess they could try to just go for the jugular. And I guess they will go for it. Try to get a first down and end the game. But there are 20 seconds left. And they can't kneel. They look like they're going to kneel it, but they don't have enough time left. And so Regis will get the ball back on the turnover of downs with 9 seconds left.
And that's what you like to see, Jake. Mullen and Regis shaking hands, giving hugs out there on the field. Looks like bad blood has been reconciled. I'm really glad to see that, Jake. So, at least something's been reconciled out there.
So, once again, Mullen had a 14-0 lead in the half. Regis Jesuit looked strong at the beginning of the second half, but Mullen really took control at the end of the third quarter and into the fourth quarter, putting up 21 points unanswered until Regis got the 41-yard touchdown pass from Matt Hotelling to John Schmidt. But other than that, there has been no hope for the Raiders. Hotelling looks to do maybe a pass. No, he's just going to pitch it to Burt, who will be taken down at the 10-yard line. So that's the game, folks. Final score here from Brother Bernard Kennedy, De La Salle Stadium. Mullen 35, Regis Jesuit 7. Steven, any final thoughts?
Jake, all I want to do is remind people of upcoming broadcasts, maybe a little. Tomorrow morning at 9 a.m., Regis Jesuit squares off with Marquette in their final game of the Jesuit Classic. So get up early, go get some breakfast, and be back to watch that either at Lou Kellogg Stadium or right here on live.regisjesuit.com.
And next weekend, Regis Jesuit is home at 7 p.m. against, I think it's Dakota Ridge. So we look forward to having you there, too. We'll have good internet because it's a home game, so thanks again. And final score from Mullen, Mullen 35, Regis Jesuit 7. On behalf of Tommy Raines, our awesome producer, our great cameraman Joe Quigley, Steven Snyder, I'm Jake Leonard. Thanks for listening. Have a good night.